Sydney and the start of the 1964 Ampol trial. We follow this long-distance event with the most unlikely car to have ever competed in Australian motorsport, the Lightburn Zeta.
...152 drivers, 14 days, 7,000 miles. The 1964 Ampol trial, possibly the world's longest and toughest, was about to separate the weak from the strong, the prepared and the unprepared, the careful and the careless. For the next 14 days, rotations of men and machines were at stake. The Ampol trial was the ultimate test of both. 43 of the cars at the start this day would not be there at the finish. Awaiting the flag at Bondi, New South Wales, was the holidaying taxi driver, as anxious to win as the chemist in front of him or the works team driver behind. Each of their cars designed, built and prepared by the world's automotive giants. Cars prepared to win, many destined to fail. The Ampol trial 1964 was a baptism of fire for an unknown car, newly born, barely christened. It was the Zeta, the lowest priced, lowest powered car ever to enter such a long, grueling reliability trial, not just in Australia, but in the world. Donald Campbell, who had used a fleet of the cars at Lake Eyre, knew what they could do and came to the start to personally send them on their way. The supreme test had begun. The first control was at Lithgow. For every minute late or early at a control, a competitor would lose 1 point. Disqualification was the cost of missing a control. Drivers were given 3 hours, 13 minutes to cover the Bondi to Lithgow section, a distance of 70 miles. In the Blue Mountains, it was a winding race to make up time. There were 3 cars and a crew of 6 in the Zeta team. In the car, a tiny but tough 325cc engine. In Zeta 78A were Ted Polgreen, a South Australian speedway driver, and Ray Chapman, a design engineer who had helped to develop Zeta. South Australia's 2 youngest trial entrants were Ian Rogers and Rick Seeley in car 82A. Both were 19. Only one of the crew, Chief Driver Bill Mayer in car 79A, had competed in a Around Australia trial. Little wonder that private bets against the Zeta were heavy. Between Orange and Wellington, drivers met their first horror stretch. Near Mullion Creek, cars slushed through mud up to 2 feet deep. Sometimes, people stood in groups, watching, waiting. These were trouble spots. Here you were expected to run out of road, hit something, or get bogged. In that first 24 hours, the course became much worse, possibly the worst of the trial. A night without stars, a low mist, a slippery surface, narrow, dangerous tracks. At Tamworth, the strain eases. There's time for sandwiches, coffee, a yarn, and perhaps some sleep. Now to Scone, an uncharted road through a dozen creek beds, a continuous winding hill and dale. Time allowed, 2 hours, 25 minutes, an uncomfortably high average to maintain. Roads where you pray nothing approaches. wide rivers, where the grip of the soil on the distant bank is the height of a shaky ambition. The control point speeds by in a blur of memory. Dungog, Newcastle, Tuncurry, Halliday's Point, Purfleet, Taree. Many cars have driven all night to reach Port Macquarie before control closes. An early arrival, Australia's most successful woman trial driver, Grandma Brown, and her son Vince. Forgetting to have your route book signed is a sure way to disqualification. For those in early, a barbecue and drinks help to lay the dust. Others check and recheck, leaving nothing to chance. At Lismore, a disappointing decision awaits Zeta driver Bill Mayer and his navigator Mike Morell. They miss a special control at Caramba. Officially, he's out, but he continues with the others. Now to Rockhampton via Casino, Murwillumbe, Coolangatta and Brisbane. Big, razor-sharp rocks try to cut tyres, put maximum stresses on engine and suspension. Of fine red dust called roads. Like granite-hard stones and the sparkling remains of the 100 windscreens they've smashed. For the driver without a windscreen, the miles are a misery of streaming eyes and choked lungs, and the cold grinds grit between chattering teeth. Rockhampton, The scene is tropical, the day is warmer now. But who has eyes for scenery? The miles roll on. Marlborough, Mackay, Townsville. Cattle grids show no mercy to front suspension. Already, the trial is over for 27 cars. Each driver's senses are strained for signs of trouble. Some even imagine it. They don't want to be number 28. Unsophisticated in the dusty warmth of an early Sunday. The Barcaldine band gives cars a rousing send-off in waltz time. People were unaware of the band, the Zeta novice team. They had damaged their car when they slid off the road into a ditch. Repairs took long enough to get them into Blackall only minutes after control had closed. For them, the trial was officially over. Hopes for the baby car were now pinned on the Polgreen and Chapman crew. No car with such a small engine capacity had done it before. Could they do it now? Kangaroos and wallabies were a constant menace. To hit one could put a car out of the trial and result in serious injury to the crew. And the lumbering walk of a 6-foot-tall emu could carry the frightened but potentially vicious bird into the path of a hurrying, time-restricted competitor's car. This was the primitive backcountry. Back of Burke, where little had changed since the days of Banjo Patterson. Except, perhaps, the main road. And when Cobb & Co. stopped at the Carrier Arms, they didn't expect to make Broken Hill in 7 hours. And there were no traffic police. The unwritten code of the outback. Always close the gate. Broken Hill, Port Pirie, Port Augusta, and the dust is over. After Adelaide, Mildura, and the last sleep until the finish, more than 24 hours away. Only yesterday, the soil was parched. Now, on the road to Melbourne, pastures are lush. At Horsham, trial veteran Jellic Knight Jack Murray shows how he got his nickname. Even while eating, Jack is the star performer. Murray's son, Crackerjack, makes his first appearance in a Around Australia trial. A chip off the old block, Junior bought fireworks. Unlike Australian folk singer Lionel Long, he didn't find time to write letters home. Warrnambool, grim in the splendour of its coastline. To Bairnsdale via Melbourne, and the trial re-enters New South Wales. It's the last leg, but organisers want to narrow down the field. Elimination sections are tricky and require high speeds. Drivers are tired. The danger of misjudgment is greater. Snowy mountains are close now. Only a few miles from the trial route, roads are covered in snow and ice. At Smiggan's Hole, a steady stream of skiers are drawn by heavy snowfalls. Girls find the exercise good for the figure. Some limbs don't need the exercise. Bob and Dawn, for example. This Zeta owner gets a thrill as she watches the distant Paul Green and Chapman crew. Near Rosedale Control, the Toyota team strike trouble. They damage a back axle on a bridge and work frantically to repair it. Drivers Shahomi Hosoya and Masaharu Tureo brought their car from Japan for the trial. They won't give up easily. Bondi is only 12 and a half hours away. Mechanical or human failure would be bitter now, so close to the finish. But there are 10 controls. Bondi. To drivers, it seems a lifetime ago that they were leaving. Now, 14 days and 7,000 miles later, mechanical and human failure have taken a big toll. 43 cars will not be here. Winner Harry Firth and navigator Graham Hoinville in a Cortina GT have earned their garland, champagne, the £3,000 prize money and the admiration of the Pretty Miss Australia entrants. Also highly admired is the tiny but tough Zeta. Zeta, the lowest priced, lowest powered car in the trial, showed it could take rough going when cars twice the price could not. And all the Zetas completed the course, though only one officially.
Zeta runabouts, followed by none other than the Zeta representative, 78. There it is. And the gentleman just came up and gave it a great big kiss. Lightburn, the manufacturer, no wonder he kissed the little thing. And he's sincerely congratulating Ted Polgreen and Ray Chapman, who took this very, very tiny car. But Zeta is wholly financed and built by Lightburn Company, would finish ahead of some other cars. A little Zeta 78 that went 7,000 miles around Australia, and to be quite truthful, I must be frank when I say this, it sounds just as good now as the day it left, which I think speaks very highly of this Australian-made car.
This was the reward for the drivers and designers who developed and perfected Australia's most versatile car, the car with a tiny but tough 325cc engine. This was the day Zeta came of age, the day Zeta smashed world records and earned the Ampol trophy for outstanding performance.